Hi, my name is Cindy Purser. I'm with the Scott County Library. And today we're going to talk about historical mysteries. And what I love about historical mysteries is that besides the mystery, you also can sometimes have some romance, some suspense, and then you get that whole sense of this time and place. So that's one of the reasons why I love historical mysteries. It's time to head to Victorian England with Tasha Alexander's Lady Emily series. The first in the series, Only to Deceive, introduces us to Lady Emily Ashton. The man she recently married and barely knew has died suddenly, leaving behind a fortune and many secrets. After finding a mysterious note in her late husband's belongings, Emily decides to investigate his death. Her search for answers takes her to the British Museum in Paris, and as she learns more about her husband in the world of ancient antiquities. Theft, forgery, and deception are revealed, and soon Emily is facing the same dangers that led to her late husband's death. There's a touch of romance along with the mystery, and it makes for a book and a series that is a cozy read. You also learn about the Victorian era and what it meant for women, especially those like Emily who wanted to pursue learning. And you might be inspired to explore Greek literature, something Lady Emily grows to love. So we're still in England, but we're moving ahead in time to the post-World War I era. One of my favorite historical mystery series is the series by Charles Todd, which is actually a mother-son writing team. It's the Inspector Ian Rutledge series. The first book in the series is A Test of Wills. The one I'm going to talk about right now is A Lonely Death. But the main character, Ian Rutledge, is a British soldier who's returned from the war and is experiencing what they called back then shell shock or PTSD. And he's struggling to just keep moving forward, battling the ghosts of the soldiers who died under his command. And these series are very atmospheric, and you certainly get a sense of what the time was like in England after the war, with so many loss of life and broken people coming back. So this book, Lonely Death, let me give you a little background on that. It's a blend of psychological complexity as it deals with Ian's battle with shell shock, and a lot of atmosphere as well. So in A Lonely Death, three men have been murdered in a Sussex village in England. Scotland Yard has been called in, and it's a really baffling case. The victims are all soldiers who survived the horrors of World War I, only to meet a ghastly end in the quiet English countryside 2 years later. Each has had their throats slit with a small ID disc left in their mouths. Scotland Yard's presence doesn't deter this vicious and clever killer, and shortly after Inspector Ian Rutledge arrives, a fourth soldier is found dead. There's very few clues to go on and a lot of pressure to solve the case, and Ian really feels like his job, his reputation, his sanity is kind of on the line. So this series is one, if you enjoy complex characters, if you want to get a sense of what life was like in England after the war, especially for those returning soldiers, and the mysteries are all very compelling. So this is one of my favorite series.
Hi, my name is Paula Lafreniere from the Scott County Library. And today, as you can see, we're talking about historical mysteries. The reason that I really enjoy them is I love to have the feeling of walking back into the past. And the writers I'm going to talk about are very good about the setting of their books. So you get this atmospheric kind of decadence in New Orleans, and then you get some other places that I'll talk about. So that's a good part of it. And I love a good mystery. I love to be surprised at the end. And I feel like these are good ones for that. So the first book I want to talk about, or the first series I'd like to talk about, is the Benjamin January series by Barbara Hambly. Just as an explanation, a little bit about the main character. Benjamin January is a former slave who was bought out of slavery by his mother's white protector, then trained as a surgeon in Paris. After marrying and earning his living there as a musician, he returns to New Orleans after his beloved wife dies. And after 16 years in Paris, he struggles with all of the unwritten rules of simply surviving as a free black man in 1830s New Orleans. He's a complex character, but very much worth getting to know. The book that I'm going to talk about is Wet Grave. In this book, January is called to the shack of a broken down prostitute who was murdered, a woman who was once rumored to be the beautiful mistress of the pirate John Lafitte. She died as a destitute drunk, stabbed multiple times, and left to be found by her neighbor. Why would someone kill her? An old drunken woman. The only clue to the killer's identity is an unusual boot print. A few days later, Rose, January's sweetheart at this time, urgently summons him to the home of her student Artois. A crate has been delivered to his home, and nestled inside are guns instead of the vacuum pump that he had been expecting. Trying to help Artois avoid coming under suspicion of smuggling guns, January suggests posting an advertisement in the paper for the true owner. The crate is claimed, and January notices that one of the men who picked it up left the same boot print that he saw at the prostitute's home. The next day, Artois is discovered dead. January is devastated and vows to find the killer. As he begins to make connections between the two murders and the shipment of guns, January and Rose and his lawman friend, Abishag Shah, find themselves at a downriver plantation, closing in on the murderer in the face of a hurricane and a slave revolt. There are 18 books in this series, all very well written and exposing a new facet of life, of living at that time period, in that place as a person of color. The author is adept at describing the setting, creating an atmosphere that becomes a character in the story. I highly recommend them. Next up, we have kind of a rather new series. It's the Bainbridge and Sparks trilogy, actually, by Allison Montclair. Gwen Bainbridge is an upper-class widow with a six-year-old boy. Because she suffered a nervous breakdown after the death of her husband in the war, she's living with her formidable in-laws, especially her mother-in-law, who have taken custody of her son. Iris Sparks, her partner, served as an intelligence operative during the war and has the emotional baggage of blaming herself for getting other girls killed during a mission. Together, they are the proprietors of The Right Sort. In the first book, The Right Sort of Man, after meeting at a wedding, Gwen and Iris decide to open a marriage bureau in post-World War II London. This is during London's rebuilding stage, and that's why you'll see on the photo that it looks kind of dreary there. After 3 months, their business is off to a good start, having successfully introduced 7 couples to their new spouse. Gwen has a knack for matching people up, as well as the uncanny ability to tell when someone is lying. Iris's intelligent work during the war gives her the means to do background checks on prospective clients. But when their newest client is murdered, apparently by the man they introduced her to, who has now been arrested for murder, they resolve to find the real killer, thereby clearing their client and saving their business. Using the same skills that have made their business successful, they follow leads and collect information with the help of their associate, the polite yet awe-inspiring Sally, and they also meet a rather interesting group of black marketeers. This is a fun, fast-moving story replete with snappy dialogue. I love the dialogue in this. It's so much fun to just listen to them banter back and forth, and also a wonderful feeling for the time period. The second book, which is out, is called A Royal Affair, and then the final book of the trilogy, A Rogue's Company, will be out in June. Now on to the Sebastian St. Cyr series. This is written by C.S. Harris. Sebastian St. Cyr is the Viscount Devlin, who served as an agent in the Napoleonic Wars. And now he uses his skills that he honed there to assist the authorities in solving murders, specifically those that involved members of the peerage, of which, of course, he is a part. He is married to a woman named Hero, whose father is a cousin and influential advisor to the Prince Regent, and he's also a little bit scary. However, Viscount Devlin is up to that that increasingly hard relationship, and comes to find out in time that his own heritage is a little bit obscure and different than what he thought it was. And this becomes a theme throughout all of the books. In this book, What Darkness Brings, Sebastian is called to Hyde Park when his friend and former military buddy is found dead. It looks as if his friend has succumbed to a deadly disease that he caught during the war. Just as he is coming to terms with this, he receives word that his former lover, Cat Boleyn, her husband, has been arrested for murder. He stands accused of killing a jeweler, and Sebastian vows to investigate just for Cat. As Sebastian delves into the murder, he discovers that there is a rather large blue diamond that is missing, wanted by both the Prince Regent and Napoleon's French operatives. There's also a thread that connects former military men, including his dead friend, to the murder, as well as yet another connection to someone who may be his half-brother. As Sebastian gets closer to the killer, both Hero and Cat may be at risk as well. This is the eighth book in the series, and there are 15 in all. It's probably best to begin with the first book as the characters develop along the way and more is revealed about Sebastian's odd background in each subsequent title. The series is actually based on historical events, and what's really neat is the author always includes notes about the time period and what was going on in the story in the back of each book and explains the context of where she set that time. This is a great way to learn history painlessly. And last but not least, let's talk about the Franny Fisher series by Kerry Greenwood. Some of you may be familiar with the series that was aired, I believe, on PBS. I haven't actually seen it yet because I just love the books too much. So let me tell you a little bit about the book part. So Franny grew up in Australia. She grew up poor in Australia, but her father unexpectedly inherited a fortune from an English relative. It's the 1920s, and Franny is now enjoying her wealth and flapper lifestyle, indulging in sumptuous food, clothing, and men. However, having been an ambulance driver during the First World War, and all in all leading a rather adventurous life up to this point, she becomes bored. And looking for something interesting to do, she makes the discovery that she actually has what it takes to be a good investigator. Flying Too High is her second adventure and involves a possible murder plot, an actual murder, and a kidnapped girl. Just to give you a little bit of context about the book, Mrs. McNaughton, a nervous and slightly hysterical woman, meets with Franny and asks her to intervene in an attempt by her son to kill her husband and his father. This is entirely based upon a sentence from a crumpled letter written by her son, as well as the fact that father and son don't get along very well and both have very hot tempers. So Franny agrees to investigate and interviews the son after terrifying him with a spectacular show of her own flying abilities. The next day, his father is dead, and the son is taken into custody. After bailing him out of jail, Franny pursues several interesting leads, and things begin to look promising. But then she receives a call about a 6-year-old girl who has been kidnapped. Leaving her compatriots, Dot, Cease, and Bert to work on the father-son case, she rushes to the home of the parents of the child. Will she be able to save the child? Will she discover the real killer of Mr. McNaughton? Will she be able to take a leisurely bath and enjoy the attentions of a certain shy physician? Read on to see. The books in this series need not be read in order. They're all totally enjoyable without a lot of background. The 21st book in the series, Death in Dalesford, will be published in June.
Thanks for sharing some time with us as we talked about some of our favorite historical mysteries. We hope that you find some mystery series at your local library. Be sure to come visit us soon.